A war that ended nearly 100 years ago. A war fought by our great uncles and aunts, our grandparents, our forebears, nearly all of them now long dead. A war best forgotten. I don't think so. And even if I wanted to forget, I could not, after walking among the war graves in the battlefields of Europe, reading only some of the millions of headstones, some of them named, many others simply labeled, known only to God. My own remembering began on a Wednesday night at 8 o'clock in a place called Ypres that once devastated but now reconstructed Belgium town, around which 500,000 Allied soldiers lie. And on that night, in the crowd that had gathered from the whole world over, I heard the last post played, as it is played every night in Ypres, under the Menin Gate. And I listened to a group of young and proud Australian teenagers, high school students, in stockman hats and oilskins. And I heard them read the Lawrence Binyon lines that we'll read again today. Those same young people were on their way to Gallipoli to join thousands of more of their own age group from New Zealand and from around the Commonwealth to stand and remember in the dawn light a war that is now three generations removed from them. And on this 99th anniversary of the beginning of World War I, and the 95th anniversary of the armistice that ended that conflict, it is remarkable that remembrances like this day and Anzac Day still continue to find new life, especially among young New Zealanders. The survivors of that nightmare war have died, but the memory of their self-giving and their sacrifice has not died. It endures as a central metaphor of our identity as New Zealanders and Australians. In Mark Haddon's marvelous novel about an autistic boy called Christopher, the young man finds metaphor very confusing, until his mother explains to him that his own name is a metaphor. Christopher is the saint who carried Christ across the river. And the boy heard that and embraced that role and became a carrier for others. And that's what days like this do for us. They carry so much of who we are and something of who Christ is for us. Such metaphors are taonga, they're precious treasures, rescued from the horror of what happened at Gallipoli and Flanders and the Somme and wherever Anzacs died alongside their Allied comrades in battles like Passchendaele, the scale of which we are only now beginning to understand. It takes 99 years to break the silence of these places. In Sebastian Falk's novel Birdsong, Elizabeth retraces her grandfather's forgotten war on the Western Front, and she visits a memorial gate at Flanders Field. And she looks up at the British names, their chiseled capitals rose from the level of her ankles to the height of the great arch itself, on every surface of every column, as far as eyes could see. There were names, teeming, reeling over hundreds of yards, over furlongs of stone. "Who are these?" she asked. "These," said the man, "they are the lost, the ones they did not find." "From the whole war?" she asked. "No," he replied, "only from these fields." Elizabeth went and sat by rows of white headstones, each clean and beautiful in the weak winter sunlight. "Nobody told me," she said. "My God, nobody told me." Days like this one ensure that there will be somebody to tell the others, to tell the story. But how do we tell it? Well, St. Paul has some advice about that. We heard it read a moment ago. Writing to Timothy as a young church leader, Paul passes on his story at two levels. First, in the lyrical language that we are fond of using on Remembrance Day, he talks of his impending death as a libation poured out, a boat unmoored for its final journey, a wreath of recognition for a life of service to others. Like a good soldier, he has finished the race and kept the faith. But then the tone of the letter changes into a language that we don't use easily on days like this, but is even more powerful for keeping memory alive. It is the concrete language of things and people and places. And Paul uses that language to confess his loneliness, to remember places once memorable that he'll never be able to visit again. Demas, his old friend, lost to him now. Crescens, gone off to found a church in Gaul. Priscilla and Aquila, he a Jew, she a Roman, who risked their lives for him once. Pudon, a senator. Linus, a bishop in Rome. An intensely personal litany of people and places, and things as well. An old cloak that he needs for the winter. Some favorite books, and above all, his precious writing paper. When I have been to the battlefields where our fathers and our grandfathers died, I am always overwhelmed by the personal detail of their diaries and their letters and what was in their pockets. On Flanders Field, only a year or so ago, they dug up a British infantryman, still curled up in his 1915 trench, clutching his rifle, and alongside him, a French dictionary a pack of cards, and a jar of Bovril. He hadn't been to Ephesus or Corinth or Galatia like Paul. His Europe was made up of Belgium places with Tommy names, Hellfire Corner, Shrapnel Crossing, Suicide Road, Dead Dog Farm. But these places and these things, like the metal debris on the heights of Gallipoli, become sacramental items on Remembrance Day. They connect like electric wires into the raw energy of memories that make us who we are. Through the detail of these soldiers' lives, we are still able to address them directly, personally, and say to them, as Paul said to his friends, thank you, thank you, thank you. May God's grace be with you as you gave your grace to us. Another word for grace is a gift beyond deserving. So thank you for such a gift. The past we harvest that was yours, the present that you gave for ours. Amen.